मचा ब्याडवा जीत कन्ना एले बाले सुली नानुवा हच्चा ब्याडा हच्चा ब्याडवा जीत कन्ना एले बाले सुली नानुवा अव्वा ಎಲೆ ಬಾಳೆ ಸುಳಿ ನಾನುವ್ವ ಬೆಟ್ಟವ ಹತ್ತಲಾರೆ ಹಳ್ಳವ ಇಳಿಯಲಾರೆ ಮುಳ್ಳಿನ ಹಾದ್ಯಾಗ ಕಳ್ಳಿಯ ಸಾಲಾಗ ದನಗಳ ಬೆನ್ನ ಹಿಂದೆ ಅಲೆದಲೆದು ದಣಿಯಲಾರೆ
Hartali village in Mysore in southern India. Most of the villagers here live below the official Indian poverty line, less than a dollar a day. And women and children bear the brunt of it. Pushpa was only 13 when she had to drop out of school and get married. By 14, she had already given birth to her first child. Today, at 15, her health as a child mother has suffered and she finds looking after her baby very difficult. You were studying in school. Why did you leave and get married?
My mother forced me to marry. She told me to stop going to school and married me off.
Is that what you wanted to do?
No, I wanted to study, but she won't let me continue.
Did you have difficulty during childbirth?
Yes, I had a lot of difficulty. I threw up a lot.
How are you managing your child? You are a child yourself.
My mother looks after my baby.
Pushpa isn't alone. In no less than 6 Indian states, the average age for marrying among rural girls is under 14 years, according to the Indian Council of Medical Research. In the Maharashtra village of Karandi in western India, Dasharath farms just 1 acre of land. Today he's working harder than usual because there's an extra mouth to feed. His wife Jayashree has just given birth to a son, a cause for great joy for the couple. But this is their 11th child. 5 of Jayashree's children have already died, 3 of them boys. Jayashree is already a grandmother. Her married eldest daughter is visiting her to see the new baby. But it was the desire for a son that's driven Jayashree to go through the process of childbearing again and again.
How is your health after so many pregnancies?
Well, I don't have a choice. It's the hope of having a son who will live. That's why I have endured so much.
Repeated childbearing combined with early marriage have always been major causes of infant mortality. 2.5 million children die every year in India, according to UNICEF. More than half of them newborn babies. But now there is a new concern. While the infant mortality rate has been declining over the last 30 years, today there are disturbing reports from over half of the states in India that the trend is beginning to reverse. The Central Health Ministry has launched an investigation into what is going wrong.
The infant mortality rates in this country, which were falling over the 90s, the rate of decline first reduced, and then over 96, 97, 98, there's almost a stagnation and probably the beginning of an increase in infant mortality.
Chronic malnutrition is a major factor in infant mortality. The UN says more than half of India's children under 4 are malnourished. The World Bank estimates that chronic malnutrition costs India $10 billion a year in loss of productivity, illness and death. The World Health Organization defines low birth weight babies as weighing less than 2.5 kilos. 1 in 3 babies in India are now born low birth weight. Doctors say it's a vicious cycle. Undernourished mothers produce underweight babies, and so it goes on from one generation to the next.
All over the country at the moment, the low birth weight rate is as high as 32.5%. That means 32 babies born out of 100 are below the weight of 2.5 kilograms.
Certainly in global terms, the largest cause of low birth weight is maternal undernutrition. And this is a problem here in India, where one third of babies are born low birth weight, and we know that that's mainly attributable to high rates of maternal undernutrition.
Low birth weight babies jeopardize the social and economic development of entire generations in the developing world. Doctors at the Holdsworth Memorial Hospital in Mysore and the Medical Research Centre in Southampton in the UK are now investigating how the effects cross the generations in South India. For the past 5 years, they've been testing 600 children born at this Mysore hospital to try and understand the links between malnutrition in the womb and health in later adult life.
146.4.
Their first results, reported in the medical journal The Lancet, indicate that low birth weight babies may be more susceptible to diabetes and heart disease as they grow older. In the town of Pune in Maharashtra, doctors at the King Edward Memorial Hospital have been researching the diet of 2,000 pregnant mothers. In the majority of cases, they found their diet was worryingly low in calories. Another study of children at Pune raised further serious concerns.
We did two studies. One was on four-year-old children and those when they became 8 years old. And to our great surprise, we could see indicators which suggested that they were compromised as far as their glucose metabolism was concerned, and they also had secular trends which suggested that they had higher pressures, higher blood pressures, even at a tender age of 7 and 8.
The director of the diabetes unit at this hospital says that in the 1970s, there were just over 2% of adults in Indian cities who had diabetes. Today, that figure has gone up to 12%.
It's a massive increase. Such increase has never been seen before. And the prediction is that within the next 20 years, India will have the dubious distinction of being the country with the highest number of diabetic patients, almost 60 million of them.
According to the Indian government, GDP is growing at 6% a year, faster than in the United States. But in healthcare, the World Health Organization statistics still ranks India at only 112th out of 191 member countries. Despite the Green Revolution, India's food supplies remain precarious. Income from agriculture is unreliable, and there's endemic hunger in many areas. In this village, the women told us that lack of work meant 3 out of 4 families go hungry. Here, the stoves are rarely lit these days.
There is no farm labor and therefore no wages. If there is a family of 10, then even 2 people don't get work. It has been 4 months since we had regular work. We starve. There is no choice. If we have no money and we go to the shopkeepers, then they don't give us anything. They tell us, you have no money. Why have you come to the shop? So we just return empty-handed and starve.
What have you eaten since the morning?
Nothing.
What about the children?
They have had a cup of coffee.
In India, the evidence is very clear. We've had the NSS data, the National Sample Survey, shows an increase in not just the absolute numbers of the poor, but in the proportion of the rural population living in absolute poverty. And it's quite a substantial increase. The data for 1998 shows that it's as high as 42% of the rural population. and that is up by about 6 percentage points from 1990, so over that decade. This has a terrible long-term effect. You know what protein deficiency does to mental development over time. And many of these effects are not reversible. So there is a real danger that we are actually undermining the next generation.
What were you saying about why we were filming here?
Yes, you're shooting the slum. So when it's demolished, you'll come and show the slum dwellers how nice your slum was. Now it's a broken ruin. That's what I was saying. What will I say?
Why will it be broken?
Why? The order is out. In 2 months, the notice will come. By the third month, the slums here will be cleared, like the Nehru Stadium slum was cleared.
Then where will you go?
Then where will we go?
Wherever the government gives us the land.
We'll go to America or London. But we'll go somewhere or the other.
The government is saying that it is opening up India to the world.
They can't look after the people who live here. They are calling the outsiders. What sense does that make? They want to make Delhi into Paris. First make Delhi the Delhi we had.
No one listens to the poor. The only time they think of us is when they come with folded hand to ask for votes. After that, they don't care whether the poor live or die. If we go to ask them for any jobs, they just tell us to leave.
Doesn't your arm ache ironing so many clothes?
Don't ask me about the physical pain I suffer. Ask me about the pain in my heart. I have to work hard and support my family. My husband is ill and needs medicine, and my own health is bad.
The poor have nothing to eat, and rich drive cars. Take a small example. It takes one machine to dig soil. 10 men used to do that work. Now one machine does it, and the work is over in about an hour. That leaves 9 men unemployed. Where will they go?
In
1991, the Indian government, along with many other countries, embraced market reforms. Under trade liberalization, the emphasis was on maximizing exports and attracting inward investment. The beneficiaries are India's middle class, now 250 million of them. But there have been big losers too. As market reforms took hold, India was also beginning to feel the effects of structural adjustment policies laid down as conditions for loans taken out in the 1980s from the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. The public health care budget and basic subsidies on food were cut. The poor were the first to suffer. Meeting of global investors in Bangalore, India's own booming Silicon Valley. India's finance minister uses the occasion to reaffirm his commitment to globalization and market reforms.
Reforms in this country have come to stay. That reforms will march forward in the first decade of the 21st century. Which I have called the decade of development for India.
Unfortunately, if you just look at the kind of super hype that is about globalization in this country, one would never think that, you know, there's anything but happiness here. But in fact, even if you look at government statistics, the most recent statistics have shown that in the last 10 years of so-called economic reform, the absolute number of India's poor below the poverty line has increased by something like 70 million.
In any globalization process or in any process, there has to be casualties. But you don't stop trying something which you genuinely believe it's for the better by for fear of casualties. I mean, if you see the conditions of India before the process started, today conditions are far better. There is a different attitude in India, there is a different approach, there is a different hope. I mean, the whole liberalization process by the creation of new entrepreneurs, new industry, etc., has given a new ray of hope. All of a sudden, there is a confidence at every level in India that, yes, we can do it. We are already seeing the fact that it has brought benefits to much larger of people than it has ever done before. India should move much faster towards globalization.
For the beneficiaries of liberalization, the party goes on.
The distinction is between the real economy and the virtual economy. There's a virtual economy out there, and it's also virtual because there is a whole class of the Indian elite that wants to think it's there and wants to wish away India, the real India, which has got hungry people and no sanitation and increasing disease and increasing child mortality.
Village of Khir Shivpur in Maharashtra, there are echoes of the Delhi slum dwellers. Here too, the new economics are bringing changes that aren't always welcomed.
I was waiting in the rain with my head covered. They came with bulldozers and pulled down our homes, shouting, "Pull it down, pull it down." It was raining heavily and we gathered our small children together. They drove the bulldozer through my house. I was sick and I told them, "Please wait." But they said, "You get out quickly. We have to pull this down now."
We don't have any other occupation except farm labor. Somehow we have managed to get some increase in our daily wages, but still there is no assurance of permanence. If we get work one day, then the next 4 days we stay at home. Our children don't get food.
Wheat is 12 rupees a kilo, rice is 10 rupees, and sugar has gone up to 15 rupees a kilo. Kerosene is 6 rupees. Before it used to be only 3 rupees. Now it is 6 rupees. How do you expect us to cook, to eat, to feed, and educate our children?
Economic indicators show that market reform policies have slashed agricultural wages by half over the last 10 years. Land degradation as a result of overuse of pesticides, together with the switch from food production to cash crops, have made farmers' incomes more erratic than ever. Statistics show suicides among farmers have risen as their crops fail and they're unable to meet their debts.
The very fact that today the rate of migration is so high, it indicates that people are not able to subsist on what they were able to subsist earlier, because the small farmer is losing his land and he has to search for food elsewhere.
Cutbacks in food subsidies have compounded the crisis caused by the loss of farmers' incomes. Prior to liberalization, India boasted a highly organized food distribution system which ensured basic food grains were available to the poor at very subsidized rates. Today, in an attempt to lessen food dependence, this system is unraveling. But, say critics of the policy, depriving India's poor of the little security they had has only aggravated the problem of an already inadequate diet.
the health profile of India's poor has seen a vast deterioration. It is not as though before globalization, you know, everybody was well-fed and healthy. You already started from a very, very low level. What globalization has done for the vast mass of India's poor is to push them further to the brink, to marginalize it further.
With globalization, there are widening inequalities, so that there are large numbers of families and therefore women who are remaining poor and undernourished. And therefore, this low birth weight problem will be perpetuated, if not worsened.
You create the poor, you create poverty, and then you punish the poor for being poor.
Ten years into the free economy, there is growing concern that India is leaving behind a major chunk of its population in its rush to join the global market. The question is, who will be answerable for these lost generations?